Hello, everyone. Welcome to Messiah Lutheran Church in Lakeville, Minnesota. My name is Pastor Bob Schultz. It's a delight to be together with you in worship today. We worship our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who Scripture tells us today is our Good Shepherd Savior. And what good news that is for us today. We want to make our beginning now, as we always do, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now.
Together we make confession of our sins and hear God's wonderful word of forgiveness. I invite you in your own private confession to think of these words and to make them your own. Heavenly Father, merciful God, you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. Knowing that, we're bold to pray that you would have mercy on us and that for his sake that you would forgive us all of our sins, and by your Holy Spirit that you would increase in us a true knowledge of you and of your will and of obedience to your word, that by your grace we might come to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us, and for his sake he's given us his only Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, and for his sake he forgives us all of our sins. To those who believe in his name, he gives the power to become the children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion at the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jesus.
word of God for today, this fourth Sunday of Easter, comes to us from the Gospel of John, John chapter 10, verses 11 to 18. I am the good shepherd, Jesus said. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I receive from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. At this time, Mr. Frerich has a special message for all the children.
Well, hello, boys and girls. I hope you are doing well on this day. And so, well, as you can see, I have a friend with me today. Yeah, I thought we're talking about sheep. And so, well, I brought one. And I brought a shepherd's staff as well. So my question for you is, do you know what a shepherd does? Some of their jobs and their responsibilities? Wow, if you haven't, they have a lot. Yeah, well, they have this because this is their only defense against bears, wolves. Yeah, because their job is to protect sheep. Sometimes sheep get a little crazy and they want to wander away from the pack. And so it's the shepherd's job to go and get it, to go and bring it back to the rest of them. And they use that to grab it by their neck and pull it back, or they use this to defend those animals that are trying to attack the sheep. Well, in our lesson today that we just heard, we're hearing about this good shepherd. And let me read to you just a verse from here today. It says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Yeah. This good shepherd that's talked about here is Jesus. Jesus, the good shepherd, and well, he lays down his life for us, his sheep. He would be willing to sacrifice himself for us. No different than a shepherd is willing to sacrifice himself just to save one sheep from wandering off and getting lost. And Jesus did that, boys and girls, by dying on the cross. By dying on the cross for you and for me and everyone. That's how he laid down his life. And as you listen to Pastor Bob read there, you could see that there was many times that it said these words, lay down my life for the sheep. Well, Jesus modeled that for you and for me. In a reading that you're going to hear from Pastor Bob in just a few minutes from 1 John, it says this, by this we know what love is, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for others. Yeah. Boys and girls, he's telling us there that we should lay down our lives for others, that we should put others ahead of ourselves. And you're like, but Andy, how do we do that? We're not going to die on the cross. No, 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 that's not what he's saying. He's saying, what ways can you put others first? Which other things can you do that if you see somebody out there that you can go and bring them back? Well, serve. You can serve by providing food for them or bringing food to the food shelf. Or maybe you can help a neighbor out who's hurting by mowing their lawn or raking their leaves. Or maybe even just talking to someone at school who always sits by themselves at the cafeteria table. Looking for ways to go out and be the hands and feet of Christ by serving others, by loving others, by talking to others. That's what Jesus means by that because, again, he's our good shepherd and we are his sheep. And so we are to go out and find the lost, find those sheep that don't know Jesus, and, well, share the good news. Share them that, hey, I know a shepherd who loves you. His name's Jesus. Well, the role of a shepherd in real times, boys and girls, it was tough. And our role today as Jesus' sheep to go out and to lay down our lives for others, it's tough. But I know what? You can do it. We can do it. That we can go out and proclaim the good news of Jesus. Well, I pray, boys and girls, that you have a fun week seeing yourselves as shepherds. God's chosen people to go out and to tell the good news to others, to find those lost sheep, to tell them about Jesus. Because he's modeled that for us. And he's died on the cross for us so that we can have eternal life and that we know that our sins are forgiven. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you guys real soon. Bye-bye.
Our second lesson for today is from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 1 to 12. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed. So the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas the high priest was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them, "By what power or by what name do you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." This is the word of the Lord. The third lesson is from the book of 1 John, chapter 3, beginning at the 16th verse. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his command: to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We have opportunity to worship God with our offerings. It's good to understand what the scriptures tell us, that he blesses us for great generosity. There's many ways that you can serve by being a blessing to others. On your screen, you'll see several ways that you can be a blessing to your congregation, to our larger community, and to the world as we give at this time. Thank you. Grace and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our scripture lesson for today will be the second reading for today, the book of Acts, chapter 4, especially verse number 7 and verse number 12. Why don't you take your Bibles out or your electronic device, whatever you want to use, that you can follow along in this important lesson for today. I want you to think about something with me today. The question, I ask it all the time. I say, how did you do that? Have you ever asked somebody that after watching them do something that you don't know how they did it, but you thought it was pretty cool that they did it? How did you do that? I remember asking my grandson, who's in second grade, that question multiple times. You see, I was helping him with distance learning for a number of months, and I'd watch that second grader's fingers flying over that iPad keyboard as he was setting up Zoom conferences, as he was following the lesson plan, listening to lectures by the teacher, finding out what the assignments were and then doing them, as he was setting up little mini conferences with other classmates, as he was jumping from one assignment to another so he could have these one-on-one conversations with the teacher, all the while he was messaging his friends and playing Minecraft. I said, how do you do that? I've had other times where I've asked that question too. I remember fairly recently I was trying to change out the wiper blade on the rear window wiper on my Durango. For the life of me, I tried everything I could, but I could not get that thing off. I tried it probably for about a half an hour, probing, pulling, trying to find where the magic switch was, but I couldn't get it off. So I brought it over to the dealer, had the mechanic look at it, and within less than a minute, he popped the thing off. He said, it's a special trick. I said, how did you do that? I ask that question a lot. My wife, Beth, she's able to sit down and throw together these meals in the amount of time that it takes me to try to stand in front of the refrigerator and decide which jam is going to pair with my peanut butter sandwich. But she does it so fast and comes up with these delightful, filling, and satisfying meals. How does she do that? Well, that's a good question for our lesson today. In fact, words very similar to that were asked in the book of Acts as we read the story. Now, the story is actually larger than just that little section in Acts chapter 4. We want to look also at Acts chapter 3. Here's the story. Christ died. Christ was buried. Christ rose from the grave. Christ ascended into heaven. The Holy Spirit was poured out on those disciples just as Jesus said would happen. And those once fearful followers were passionate proclaimers of the resurrected, risen Christ. Wherever they went, they proclaimed Jesus Christ. Acts chapters 3 and 4 tells us about an encounter when one day Peter and John, two of the disciples, went into the temple courts. And while they were there, they saw a man who was crippled from the time of his birth, who had his hands out begging for alms from passers-by. Peter saw the man, he heard his appeal, and he proclaimed to him the words we heard in our text. Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. And taking him by his right hand, he helped him, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. Acts chapter 3, verses 6 to 8. Now, as you can well imagine, that particular incident caused a tremendous stir in the community. Everyone was filled with amazement. So Peter seized the opportunity with all these people trying to figure out what happened, seized the opportunity to proclaim the gospel message of the risen Christ. And you know what happened? Hundreds of people's lives were changed. In fact, it tells us that day that some 5,000 people came to faith. But it also landed Peter and John in prison. You see, the temple guards, The elders of the people, the high priests, officials, the members of the Sadducees were incensed at this message of a risen, resurrected Christ. And the disciples proclaiming this resurrection from the dead was more than they could handle, understand, or even believe. And yet they were confronted with the fact that here was this man who everybody knew was always the guy that was sitting there begging for alms, who had been crippled since the day he was born, and now he's walking and leaping and praising God. How do they explain that? So they demanded, how and by what power or by what name was this accomplished? Well, boldly, Peter proclaims, look at verse 10 in chapter 4. It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. And then the words in our text for today, verse 12, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. No other name. Now, you have to agree, that's a pretty strong statement, especially in this day and age. No other name. That's the message of Scripture. A person may not believe it, may not accept it, may not even want to hear it, but it's important to know what the Bible says. In fact, Jesus said of himself, John chapter 14, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Now, how do you share a message like that? There's lots of people that might say, well, you can't say something like that. How that sounds arrogant to say that that's the only way you can be saved. It sounds exclusivistic. It sounds egotistical. It sounds like maybe you're portraying Jesus in a different way than he said of himself. Unless, of course, you know that's exactly what Jesus said of himself. In the day and age that we live in right now, it's a fascinating time. Many people are seeking a deeper spirituality. Many people are looking for answers to life's hard questions. People are seeking a closeness with God, however they understand what that God is or might be. And many, after exploring the philosophies of the ages, have come to understand that there's got to be something else. And many of those seekers have been encountered by that same living Jesus Christ and have come to faith and to believe in him. They found their way, or should I say, Jesus found them and worked in them faith to believe and to live and to follow him. Such has been the experience of many. Maybe that's your story. Cumbered by a load of care, burdened by the troubles and the trials of each day, and maybe things in particular to you, suffering the ravages of what time can do and sickness, even fearing death, problems at work, relationship issues at school, things you cannot sort out, and you cry out, oh God, help me. Today, millions of people are looking for something. They're not sure what it is. They're not sure where to find that. They seek fulfillment in things like success or possessions, keeping busy, having lots of toys, trying to be popular, trying to have countless relationships with people, but that password to peace of mind is an elusive thing. And so they keep on searching. Many people are looking for what real spiritual enlightenment would mean and have found in the church or in a Christian that they met at work or at the gym the message of life in Jesus Christ. Maybe, just maybe, that's why you're watching or listening to this service today. God is calling you through his word. Now, you might wonder, can a person really know God? Is that possible? Well, it most definitely is. And have I ever got good news for you? It's not so much how hard can we seek after him, it's to know and understand that he loves us and he is seeking after you. He's the one who goes looking. He's the one who loves us first. He's the one who desires our rich relationship with us. Now, that's right. The scripture tells us that the very God of all creation, the one who created the heavens and the earth and all things, had this love relationship with and for his creation right from the beginning. And he pursues that relationship with countless acts of love. Now, unfortunately, that relationship hasn't been a reciprocal one. You see, humankind has this perverse way of when God says, go this way, we find ourselves going this way. When God says, here's the truth, goes looking for the truth someplace else. Humankind tends to move in a direction opposite the way God is calling. Now, not one of us here today is immune from that. That particular power that the scriptures identify as sin power and what it can do in our lives is something terrible. God says, go this way, and we run the opposite direction. And then we come up with these most clever and creative ways of trying to explain away our most heinous acts. That clever rationalizing isn't just for four-year-olds, but we might find ourselves in our own weakness doing the same thing. But you know what happens? When your sin runs headlong into God's holiness, God is always going to be the winner. God's truth is always going to be the final truth, the only truth. God is going to have the last word. He calls our sin and our rebellion for what it is. And we learn from his word that that sin and rebelliousness in our human nature would ultimately separate us from his love forever. And so people, it's no wonder, are left longing and looking for a way, any way, to find their way back to God. Well, the problem is we can't find our own way back to God. I can't rid myself of my sin. Sin in us is like malware in a computer. It infects everything and it affects everything. Not only does it affect me or you, but it's spread to every other person. The scriptures are blunt in saying what's the problem. It says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Nobody's righteous, no, not one. That would be terrible news unless it was met with this wonderful good news, the but of what God has done for us. For God, in his grace, has saved us through faith. He tells us it's not of ourselves, it's his gift, that nobody has anything to boast about. Ephesians chapter 2, 8 and 9. In sending Jesus Christ, two things happened. Number one was the righteous demands of God's holiness were satisfied in the sacrifice and the death and the resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. The second thing is that the benefit of all that sacrifice and all that it means are given, imputed, credited to you, that you might be saved through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. My debt is paid. Your debt is paid. And we're set free. In Jesus' sacrifice, God's conditions are met. A curious thing. The legislator who wrote the law is the same as the judge who pronounced the sentence, who also happens to be the person who paid the fine for you and for me. Do you remember what it says in John chapter 3, verse 16? Lots of people know the verse. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. That's such good news to people like us. Now just think what it means. What I can't forget, the sin and the failures in life and love, God can, God does. As the prophet Isaiah proclaimed, Isaiah 43, verse 25 of God, he says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Those of you who know and love and follow Jesus Christ, do you ever stop to think that people are actually watching you? Those who know that you confess that Savior Jesus Christ are wondering, what does that mean? What does that look like? How does this work? How do you handle the fastballs that life throws at you? How do you handle it when there's trouble, despair, depression, anxiousness, serious illness, loss, death, all those things that come to us with pandemics? How do you handle those things? And what an opportunity to say, we're not perfect, but I have a perfect Savior. I have a God who loves me and knows me and walks with me and helps me to trust and love in Him. In a nutshell, that's why it makes it so important for us to be able to proclaim and remember the words of Peter. He spoke before those people right from the moment of his arrest. He said, salvation is found in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given to man by which we must be saved. Jesus, Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus Christ, the name above all names, our beautiful Savior, our glorious Lord. He proclaimed Jesus, and thousands of lives were changed. Now understand this, knowing the name doesn't mean just being able to say the words Jesus Christ. Knowing the name is to know, to love, and understand this Jesus Christ, the one who lived and who died and who rose again. John, one of the disciples that was there when that lame man's legs were healed, watched him as he jumped up and praised God, saw the astonishment on his face and on the face of all the people at the temple that day. One of the men was John. John went on to write a careful account of the life and the teachings of Jesus Christ. Toward the end of the thing that we call the Gospel of John, here's what he said. These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. John chapter 20, verse 31. Knowing the Good Shepherd. Loving the Good Shepherd. Listening to the Good Shepherd. Hearing his voice and knowing that he knows us. He loves us. And he goes with us as well. So there's an invitation there, isn't there? There's an invitation for each one of us, rejoicing in our Savior. And for those of you that don't know Jesus Christ and would love to, rejoicing in the opportunity that he holds out in the free gift of life in his sacrifice for you. The same resurrected Savior that astonished the people in John and Peter's day is still astonishing people today. Jesus said of himself, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Spirit-empowered and emboldened disciple Peter proclaimed, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And as our lesson said today, salvation is found in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given to man by which we must be saved. Jesus Christ. Amen. That's how God did it. Amen. And now may God's peace, which passes all of our understanding, guard your hearts and your minds, keep you through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing a song now. The song for today is a confession of faith, just like a creed put to music. Let's sing together.
We know is doubt and fear.
Trusting in God's promises and believing His word, we're bold to come before God with our prayers and our petitions, the prayers on our heart and the prayers that will be spoken out loud together. Together, let us pray. We pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you sought out your sheep and you gathered us with them into your one flock. Keep us always in the fold. Guard us from every danger. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord God, you breathed new life into the world through the resurrection of your Son. And so now, by your Holy Spirit, we pray that you would breathe new life into your church, that freed by his gospel, we would always confess the name of Jesus Christ, the only name given by which we must be saved. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal Lord, it was through your Son that you brought peace, reconciling the world to yourself. Today, we plead for your mercy. Renew us, restore us, reconcile us in that peace. By your gift, grant peace and healing to our country, to our broken and hurting communities, between peoples, even between the nations of the world. O Lord, soften our sometimes hardened hearts, that your love in us would overflow to those around us, that you would break down barriers that keep us from loving others as you have loved us, and that we and all our neighbors would live together in harmony. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, by Christ's resurrection from the dead, you secured forgiveness for our troubled consciences. You give us the final victory over sin and death and the devil. So we're bold to pray today that you would bless with health and with well-being those who suffer among us, those who are emotionally distressed, those who are physically burdened, and those who are facing their final days. Grant your aid in this moment, and even more so one day, that true immortal health in the world to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray your blessing on our congregation. We remember today Messiah's food shelf ministry, outreaching to our community to serve the needs all around us as we serve in love and as we serve you, our Lord and Savior. We pray for our mission of this season, Camp Omega, a ministry to families and to children, to those who know and who don't know Jesus Christ, especially as our camp and its staff get ready for such an active ministry over the summer. Watch over them, bless the communities of people that get to go to camp this year. And Lord God, now we pray that you would grant us your Holy Spirit so that even as our good shepherd knows us and helps us in every trouble, we also would know and trust him and seek and find comfort in him and gladly obey his voice and in him alone find eternal salvation. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Together we pray as our Lord and Savior taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Receive now the benediction and the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen.
praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Let earth and heavenly saints proclaim the power and might of His great name. Let us exalt
God's blessings on you and on all of us as we go from this place out into the world, wherever that is for us, to the ends of the earth or to the ends of the block, proclaiming our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. So now, go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.